Okay, hello. I've been meaning to do a clip about my UFO abduction experience. And actually, some people have encouraged me to do so because they're curious and I'm tired of retyping it, and I suppose I want to document it. Fortunately, I only have one such experience, and it is in March of 1989. I do not have a specific date. It wasn't that traumatic of a thing. It was very strange, but I carried on. And all I know is that it was on a weeknight, because I remember which job I had then. So this was March of 1989 on a weeknight, and it took place in a rented apartment that I had for many, many years in Brooklyn, New York, USA. I see no reason why not to give the address, 10 Ocean Parkway. I had been sharing an apartment in the building for about some time over a year, and I got my own place a couple of floors down and was there for over a decade, well over a decade, in my own apartment, which was haunted. And I do have a clip up about that. It was very interesting. Again, that didn't bother me that much. It bothered other people a lot more than it did me. So in March of 1989, I was in my second marriage, which lasted 9 years of legal marriage and 3 years of relationship, so 12 years altogether. Like everyone else, pretty much, including a subtenant, well, two subtenants, my second husband had a problem with the apartment. It was a very good rent-stabilized apartment in an Art Deco period building on Prospect Park Southwest, and I liked it. It was secure. I had proper reinforced gates up on the kitchen window by the fire escape that were fire department approved, so you could get out in an emergency without having to unlock anything. I always felt safe in there. I got used to the nonsense that was going on in there, and it wasn't a problem for me, but it was a problem for my second husband, who usually worked at home in my apartment, even before he lived there, and he was a writer, and he had all kinds of problems with poltergeists and noise, and the neighbors had problems, and it ended up in court, but that's another story. So, in my misguided generosity, I bought him an apartment one subway stop away on another part of Prospect Park, and he used that as his base for writing, and we spent weekends there, and during the week we were usually in the rent-stabilized apartment. In the purchased apartment, we had a cat I had rescued and nursed back to health. It was a white cat with short hair, and it had two black spots over its eyes and a black tail. It had cute markings. But it stayed there in the purchased apartment and was quite used to it, was very happy to be rescued, and was used to staying several days alone at a time. No problem. If I forgot and fed the cat during the day or in the morning, it would sleep and then scamper around at night in the purchased apartment and annoy us. We slept on a fold-out couch bed there, and it was down near the floor, and I could see the cat scampering around, making noise. Adult cat, he got fed every 2-3 days, and just had water and nibbles otherwise. But you know, if you have a cat or cats, if you don't watch it, they can be very lively at night. unless you weigh them down with something to eat. But we were in the rental apartment because it was during the week, and I woke up in the night, and the cat was scampering around and peering at me. And I opened my eyes, and I thought, well, that's strange. I did not have sleep paralysis. I was staying immobile. Maybe I had sleep paralysis, but I don't think I did. I don't believe I've ever experienced that, by the way. I thought, okay, which apartment am I in? There's no cat in this rental apartment. Why is the cat scampering around? Then I realized that there was more than one creature, and they were looking at me, and I guess they were little grays. I don't know what that was. They did move very quickly and completely silently. It was weird. Quickly and silently. So I was lying there. The apartment was overheated, so I was sleeping on top of all the sheets. And my spouse at the time was a very, very light sleeper. Extremely light sleeper. And this was the only time in 12 years that I knew him that he just slept like the dead. I couldn't even hear him breathing. And he didn't wake up for any of this. I've heard about this happening. You know, the spouse will just be out to lunch. No help at all. And I felt fear, not terror, because I was awake. My eyes were open. I could feel the sheets under me. The room was not that dark. But I wasn't... I was fearful. And I thought, oh, maybe this time they'll take him. Now that's a disturbing thought. It's not a very noble thought either, but you're going to think what you're going to think under such circumstances. But no, they were there for me. They floated me up off the bed and somehow through a closed window. And I was sleeping in the buff because the apartment was really overheated. And I remember thinking, well, it's March. You know, March is very cold usually in New York City. It's a terrible month weather-wise usually. And I remember thinking, why am I like in this warm bubble floating horizontally four stories above a back alley? This is weird. And the window was still closed, of course. Weird. Then I went up somehow, and that's all I remember. I have some impressions of some other things, which make no sense to me. So I woke up in the morning. I was fine, I guess. And I teased my spouse at the time, and I said, well, you weren't any use last night. The little green men got me, or whatever. And I want to let you know at this time, I had not read abduction materials that I recall. I hadn't read any books. I hadn't read Communion by Whitley Strieber. I wasn't to read that for another couple of years. And that particular description of floating out through a closed window and going up, I don't believe I was biased to think that. Nor do I think I knew about these little grays or the big grays or whatever. I had an interest in UFOs, but that's as far as it went. And I hadn't done that much reading on it. I was born in 57, and there actually wasn't that much reading. You know, there was Barney and Betty Hill and Incident at Exeter, and for a kid in Ohio, that was about just about all I could find at the public library. Okay. So he just kind of said, you know, maybe, oh, I don't know what he said. But I remember thinking, well, maybe I should lay off the sauce. which is always a good idea. I had graduated. I had gotten my MBA a couple of months earlier. I was very relieved. But I think I was handling it pretty well. So I guess I was stressed because the marriage wasn't going particularly well, to put it mildly. And I had a long-term temp job in a big international law firm, and I had just been doing it long-term, off and on, because it paid very well. And I was well qualified to do that work, and they kept asking for me back and offering me a permanent job, and I just kept saying no, thank you. So it was kind of stressful. It was mind-numbing work. Paid well. So, wasn't exactly the happiest time of my life, but there wasn't anything really wrong either. Okay. So when I got to the office, I remember joking at some point during the day with some coworkers, haha, I think the little green men got me last night. I went out, you know. And they were kind of like, haha, you know, they didn't care. We all went back to work, and I was really okay with it. I mean, what can you do? You can't do anything, so you carry on. Then I had a health problem, and I had to have surgery in, I think it was January of 1990. And it turned out to a 20-minute simple operation ended up taking a couple of hours. And I remember coming out of the anesthesia briefly, which does happen, it's totally normal, and seeing the doctor who had referred me was there in the operating theater looking. Apparently the surgeon had called her over. Her office was not far away on the Upper East Side of New York, and she had come over to have a look. And he said to me afterwards, wow, you were a mess in there, you know, you had this and that problem. But what's with your female organs? And I was kind of like, well, I don't know, you tell me. He said, I've never seen anything like it before. This was a very sober man, a top surgeon, and actually OBGYN. And he said everything was rearranged in there. And he had never seen anything like it. Now, that's all I know. I just focused on recuperating and getting back to work. By that point, I was working for myself. And a few months went by, and I thought about it. And I thought, maybe I should see somebody about this. So I don't remember who I asked, but I got a referral to a fancy Park Avenue psychiatrist, very expensive. And he took umbrage with me because I immediately negotiated to pay half the fee. And I went for about a year, and I always paid him. He got paid. I don't think he liked working for a discount, but he charged way too much. So I just said, you either cut it in half or I don't come. So he accepted half. And at the end of the treatment period, my second husband asked for permission to join us. And I said, yeah, sure. And the doctor said, okay. If she says it's okay, sure. And my second husband said, okay, so all this money's been spent, fine. What's the diagnosis with regard to her? And he said, I think she's okay. She may be borderline bipolar, but she may not, and I don't feel any medication is indicated. He had tried to prescribe one thing before, and my second husband researched it, and he said, no, tardive dyskinesia is a known side effect, and if you're not even sure of a diagnosis, no. So I agreed, and I wouldn't take that. Since then, I got tardive akathisia, which is awful. But that's another story, and that's here in France. Over here in France, by the way, I've also been repeatedly given a clean bill of mental health. They have noticed a few weird things, but they don't know what it is, and sometimes I've just been traumatized, and I just have to resolve that with maybe talk therapy, group therapy, just normal stuff, you know, and just get over it, and, you know. So, that's as far as my UFO abduction experience goes. The Park Avenue shrink did say that it was very likely a hypnagogic hallucination. And I had said, I know I was awake. And he said, oh, your eyes were definitely open. You definitely could feel the bed sheets. You could see the room. But you were in an REM state. It happens to people. And apparently hypnopompic is when you're waking up and you might see or hear something. And hypnagogic is when it's some other thing that has to do with that. And it's kind of a misplaced sleep state while you've got your eyes open. And I accepted that. I mean, and I hope that's all it was, really. Other things have happened, things that happened before, not too often, thank heaven. I'm saying a lot, but this is unscripted, as you can tell. So that's about it, and I would say that I feel that there are a heck of a lot of people out there selling something and muddying the waters. For whatever reason, I don't care to speculate. And that's a shame, because you have people such as myself who have nothing to gain and possibly something to lose by discussing this freely. And if it was just a hypnagogic hallucination, okay, to me, I have 2 degrees in the sciences. That is scientifically interesting. Human behavior is interesting to me. Medicine is interesting to me. So I won't just discount it, especially not if something happened to me. So I would say, you know, I wouldn't just say, oh, none of that is anything, there's nothing to it. There's nothing to anything like that, because I'm here and I had an experience like that. I've put up a lot of clips and I've never even bothered. I've mentioned this in comments and PMs, but I've never even bothered doing a clip on it. And I don't consider it of primary importance in my life. There are a lot of other things, good and bad, and neutral, which are much more important, I think. But remember, I don't think that there's a black and white in life. There is not right and wrong. There are gray areas. And we just can't know everything. We can't. We don't. Right? So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. After all these years, I don't know what to make of that experience. If I got rearranged down there, fine. I guess. There's nothing I can do about it. You know? I've had some strange dreams, which sort of alluded to that since that time. But I know I was asleep. If I wasn't asleep, what can I do about it? I can't do anything. I can't prove anything. So that's it. I hope you liked it. I just said again. I would say don't write off the UFO, paranormal, abduction, experiencer thing offhand. That's not fair. I guess I hope it never happens to you. But just because something hasn't happened to you doesn't mean that you can discount it. You know, you may have never harpooned a whale. You may have never seen a whale. Does that mean that whale hunting has never existed and does not exist now? No, it does not. Okay, I hope you found this amusing. Be well.